left. So I have jumped, like I did at a certain juncture before, a bunch of chapters just so that we could get some other things down. So we've been looking at the book of Revelation and light of law and grace. And somebody said to me, really, just a few days ago, actually, they said, well, a certain juncture in my life, I got into hear and obey. And that was my relationship with the Lord, hear and obey. And I said, well, the relationship is a relationship of law. Now, they're not there now. The parts weren't necessarily law. In other words, it didn't involve, slaying beasts and, all that kind of stuff. And it didn't involve the Ten Commandments. But it was like, well, when I hear the Lord tell me something, I said, but, you know, God wants a greater relationship than just hear and obey. And that relationship is more along the lines of law. It has nothing to do with knowing his heart. In other words, in fact, what I said was, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. But if you just hear and obey, and you don't hear and then try to pursue his heart, because that's the fallacy of email and stuff like that, is that you can email somebody and they can get really upset with you and go, what do you mean by that? And you go, something sweet. you're going, I don't know what you got out of it. And I've had to look back over mine and go, well, I'm still having a hard time seeing how this could be, so I used to be more lazy, and I used a lot of more internet language, and I don't as much now. I try to write things out very longhand and make sure that everything's clear, so there won't be any misunderstandings. Well, how much more just hear and obey the heart of the Lord, the voice of the Lord, but not know the heart of the Lord, and not hear the heart of the Lord in it, and not learn the Lord in it, but just hear whatever he tells, Isn't that what Israel said when Moses came down from the mountain? And, and they said, well, whatever he tells us to do, we will do it. Well, they didn't, they didn't. They broke the law. Everybody breaks the law. And so the new covenant is that Christ, that we are in Christ, that we're one with him, that we learn him by heart and we learn him by nature. And we're not just trying to be Christians. We're trying to know Jesus. And if that's what a Christian is, then that's what we are. But if Christianity is defined by just obeying rules and laws, that's no different than the old covenant. It's just a different set of rules and ways of going about it. So, in the book of Revelation, and we started out, and this has been kind of a long journey because it actually took us back to the beginning of last year's year of seeking his heart when I was in Ireland, and the Lord released over several nights the progression from being the church to becoming the bride of Christ or the wife of the Lamb. And that progression is a progression that changes us, but only in this way. It doesn't make us better Christians. I mean, certainly it does, but I mean, that's not its goal. It changes us as to how we relate to him, as to how we relate to him. And I forget where it is, but I'm sure some of you here would remember in the Old Testament where it says that I found you in your blood. You remember that verse, And I found you there, and you were, beat up, and you were, destitute and all this. And I took you in, and I saved you, and I washed you, and I cleansed you, and I married you. But you're not getting this. You're still treating me as if I'm just a savior. You're just treating me as one who pulled you out of your mess, but you never saw what was in my heart to join with you. And so in the New Testament, we are called, all of us are called sons of God, even though there's women, and we're also, all of us are called the bride of Christ or the wife of the Lamb. It's not a gender thing. It is a reality of relationship whereby we relate to Christ differently then number one, old covenant or law. Number two, simply trying to hear and obey, or this, simply based on He finding us in our blood, cleaning us up, bringing us into His home, and we never realize what was in His heart when He did that, and so we just act like foreigners, we act like servants, we act like someone who got saved, and so we come up to Him, and He has other things in His heart, and we come up to Him, and go, oh, thank you, Jesus, thank you for saving me, thank you, I love you, Jesus, I love you, and then walk off, and He's going, that's weird, you know, because that's not what was, you know, His desire. His desire was that we would be one with Him, and in so being like a vine and a branch, and so being that He is the vine and we're the branch, and all that is in Him can come into us, and they are not gifts. They are resources of the nature and life of Christ. They are internal things. He's not just giving branches. You know, here, you know, Christmas tree fruit, hanging some pretty lights and some pretty ornaments on us so that we go, oh, look at me, I have all nine ornaments of the Spirit, all nine gifts of the Spirit or whatever, and yet we're still on the old tree, see. We haven't been taken out of something and brought into something, and for us that into something is called a hymn, and that hymn is by nature a lamb. And which is the greatest leap that you can actually have, because it's a leap from total selfishness in ourselves to being provided with a nature which is Him that can produce all the things that is not natural to us, you know. And then, you know, we can call it the fruit of the Spirit and everything, but that's not our fruit. See, that's Him, that's by His Spirit at work in us to bring forth one after His kind, which was the very beginning in Genesis. And let us make man in our own image after our likeness. So, in the book of Revelation, particularly chapter 21, is where the big opening finally starts. The progression, the book of Revelation begins with the seven churches, and it's churches. And where are they located? In the earth. And what is their basic state? Bad. They're going through all kind of stuff, and they got all kind of junk happening and stuff. And the Lord is having to write letters to what should be His bride, but they're so far from Him because they're in the earth instead of living in Him. We live and move and have our being. That's the way Paul described it. And that's the should be our relationship, that we're as a branch drawing out of Him instead of as a Christian on the earth just waiting for the moment God will touch me in a service or, you know, something like that. We're still earth dwellers. We're still earth dwellers instead of in Christ dwellers and knowing who He is and therefore knowing who we are. See, we're trying to know who we are without knowing who He is. And who He is who we are. We're not God, but we have His nature at work in us. And we're after His kind. So chapter 21, everything between chapter 3 of Revelation up to 21 is this battle between beasts and lambs. It is the battle of beast and all that follows beast, and a battle of lamb and all that follow lamb. And we've gone through this now, we've looked at it closely, and what we found out is that when beasts come up against lambs, beasts win, but they don't win because we lay down our lives like Christ did on the cross, and by His nature there is a victory that is not like earthly understanding of victory, and it releases something of His nature and of His of that resurrection to come. And so we get to 21, and now it begins to talk about the bride or the wife of the Lamb. Same thing, it's just different terminology there. And the bride is going to be more in his image than the church. The bride is a corporate, it's us. It's the church that has changed relationship with the Lord, where now it is based on his heart, not everything based on what I need, what I want. And Jesus, you're God, fix me up and give me this and give me that, and, you know, all this kind of stuff. The relationship has changed. And so now we begin to get that description here in verse 2 of Revelation 21. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. Okay, so this is a description for us. This is an, as it were, I'll just put it like this. I don't know if this is the best wording. This is an introductory presentation of what we're headed for. Where, and I'm not talking about future. I'm talking about spiritually. In other words, I'm not talking about end times. I'm talking about spiritually. That we are headed, the goal is that we are headed toward reflecting a certain image. The very thing before there was a fall, the very thing before the devil showed up, the very thing that was said out of God's heart. I mean, almost the only thing that was said of a personal level out of God's heart in the creation. You know, let there be light, you know, let there be vegetation, let there be this and that. Let us, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, Elohim, let us make something for us that would be after our image and likeness. So we get here, and in the book of Revelation, we begin to see that transition has happened from worshiping the Lamb before the throne to reflecting the Lamb. And so verse 2 says, and I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem. That's the bride, and it says that, and it'll even say it more clear in just a moment in the same chapter. New Jerusalem coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. All right, so let me just read a little bit here. There is a certain image that God wants the bride to reflect. It is the image of the Lamb who came down from glory and gave himself for others. So you see this in Philippians 2. Let this mind, let this attitude, because, you know, the word right there actually is the word attitude. It's not a mental thing. It's not get understand the mind of the Lamb. It is reflect the attitude and way of Christ crucified, the Lamb, the one who laid down his life. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who thought it not a thing to be grasped after to be equal with God, but became as a man. So here you see him coming down, and we see that as him talking. You know, the incarnation is first, and then the cross is next. He came down, became as a man, became a servant while a man, and then he became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. And so we usually see two things there, and I've heard commentators say, yeah, this talks of the incarnation, and this talks of the cross. But in reality, it's not really talking about an event at all. It's talking about an attitude and the nature, the spirit of the Lamb. And one is that he was from above as God and he became man. And the other one is, as man with that same nature and mind in him, he laid down his life so that everyone else would benefit. It's an incredible, you know, thing. And yet when we doctrinalize it and divide it all up, we go, well, this is all this. And we miss his heart. We may understand the basic things it's saying, but we don't understand the heart from which it was said, and that's God's heart. So these verses, I think, in my opinion, this verse 2 is a beautiful thing to him. To us, we always relate, okay, well, this is us. We're the bride, we're the body of Christ, this is us. And so we're looking at us in this instead of looking at what he's finally getting that he wanted in Genesis chapter 1. Verse 26. I mean, because see, we're still, you know, our minds are still with us, but the heart of the wife of the Lamb is with him. She notices little reflections in his face and goes, "Oh, do you need me to get?" I mean, really, this is true. I'm telling you, she knows his heart. You know, if you're looking around, what do you need? You know what I mean? There's a spirit, there's a nature at work in her that he loves. But we may not notice that in the scriptures. And here it is, the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven. There it is. That's the brightest point in this thing, and I'll prove it here in just a minute. That's the brightest point in this thing, because she's not just doing something. She's coming down from God out of heaven. She is doing something by his spirit and his nature. All right, so verse 9 and 10. And there came unto me one of the seven angels who had the seven bowls full of the seven last plagues and talked with me, saying, "Come here and I will show thee the bride, the Lamb's wife." And so here it is important to see these designations. It is possible for us to emphasize the bride over being the Lamb's wife. Yes. Glad to see the response. It is possible that, I mean, come on. Let's look at the difference between a bride and a wife. We go, "Well, the bride is, you know, I just love my Jesus, you know." And it's all ooey gooey. And you know, let's talk about a wedding. The wedding's all about the bride, right? And the veil, where's that at? Over her face so that he removes that? Anybody see a perversion in any of that stuff? The veil is over his face, it says in 2 Corinthians. And that veil, we're supposed to have that veil rent off of us that we might see his face. And we pervert it all and we make it about us. And so the term bride, I think, personally, nobody's getting married anytime soon here, are you? Okay, good. Is really, we can get our little soulless fingers and, you know, needs and wants all into that and go, "I'm the bride, I'm," you know, well, first of all, you're not the bride, we are, you know, but we pervert that. You almost never hear anybody call us the wife of the Lamb, although it's used right here with bride. The wife of the Lamb, this means they're one for sure. And it also means she knows who she's one with. Yeah, she knows. See, this isn't, you know, a bride can be deceived. Can I get an amen? She can get deceived, you know. "Oh, I'm the best man for you. I tell you, I'll be a good husband," you know. She's going, He called me sweetie or something, I don't know, you know. You know, so it must be true. You know, and her little heart flutters, you know. Whereas the wife of the Lamb, she loves the one who's going to give himself. She loves his way. She loves his nature. She loves his mind. She's committed to it because she's wife of the Lamb. She's committed to that. All right. So, I mean, it would be like when me and Deb met and you know, and I could have said, we were in Bible school, and I could have said, "Well, I, you know, here's our future. I'm going to become the pastor of a little flock, and we will grow, and, you know how these churches are at that time, big churches that you end up with, lots of money and driving nice cars, and, you know, and it's just going to be wonderful, you know." And she could have gone, "Oh, that's what I want." But I said, you know, I've begun to see Jesus by the Spirit in the Word, and I have no clue where we're going to end up, but we're going to follow the Lamb. That's what we're going to do. And it's going to be rough, and there's going to be a lot of hard stuff, and there'll be times where we don't have enough money, and da-da-da-da, so what do you think? Okay, she still didn't know. Well, I kind of said yes to Jesus, but I didn't know that he was like. I thought I was going to get all that stuff. I mean, I really did. I thought it was all about me. And that he was going to take care of me, and my life was going to be so much better now. I was the black sheep of the family, and now I'm going to be loved by my whole family because I'm saved. And, of course, they hated me. Everything's good now, and I've led almost all of them to the Lord. Well, all of them. But at the time, they didn't like me because I was full of myself, not Jesus. This Spirit that it's communicating, the wife of the Lamb, oh, God, God looked around and said, there's no match for the man. Everything has a match, a lion and a lioness, and, go all the way through, everything has it, but no, and God knew that, and when he made Eve, he put Adam into a deep sleep and opened his side just like Jesus is on the cross, and he took a rib out from him and formed her, and she wasn't dirt. She was him. She wasn't a follower. She wasn't a Christian. This is a Christian rib. This is not it. This is not a Christian rib. This is him. That holy thing that's in you, call it Jesus. So, we read that holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven. Coming down from God out of heaven. But here, if you're going to use the term pride, bride, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. I mean, my wife, when she wants to get some new dress, or new clothes, or, something like that, she says, well, I want you to look at it, and if you like it, I'll get it, because she wants to look good to him. Well, this is us. This is our heart. Whether you're male or female, you're part of this Spirit that says, I'm about Jesus, I'm not about myself. Okay, so, but this isn't the only place. So we came down to verse 9, and or verse 10 now. And he carried me away in the Spirit to a great and high mountain and showed me that great city, the holy Jerusalem, descending out of heaven from God. It's speaking of the same thing. It is her. It is, and he said, have you seen the bride, the wife of the Lamb? Then he shows her this. And so let's settle it. New Jerusalem isn't some city we're going to get to live in glory. It is who we're going to be. And that's what it says right here. So then when it begins to describe her throughout, well, she has stones and she has gates and she has walls and she has all of this, we go, well, say, that's a city. Well, that's him. He built us. Upon this rock I will build my church, and then I will fill it, and what's sitting in the middle of that? The Lamb on the throne. Okay? So it says that she's descending. So there's that descending thing again. This is the nature. This is his Spirit. He's coming, she's coming out of heaven. We're all trying to get to heaven. But you see that Spirit? She's making herself low. She's coming out of him from God to be with him, because both of them relate to her and him. And to be with him in the earth, in the way that she gives herself. I probably have it written here better than I can yell at you right now. In these verses, we see a consistency of description concerning the wife of the Lamb. There is a descending way about her. Amen? There's a descending way about her. Most want to be exalted as the bride of Christ. You see that? You use that term, bride of Christ, and that makes us feel exalted or something instead of getting lower and being as he is. Most want to be exalted as the bride of Christ instead of being like him. See, the goal isn't to join. Okay, here we go. Some girls marry a guy because he's got money. Others could marry a guy because he's got power. I've seen good-looking girls marry really ugly guys. Anybody ever seen that before? Good, all three of us. No, there's nothing more. But I mean, you just kind of go, I've looked and gone, what does she see in him other than that Armani suit and that Maserati they just stepped on? Well, she's not seeing that in him. She's seeing that in what she's going to get when she joins to him. See? Well, folks, that's a whole bunch of Christianity has that same spirit. That same spirit. Okay? So I said they want to be exalted as the bride of Christ instead of like him. All right. That's the deal right there. Like him. I want to be conformed to the image of Christ. I don't want to just live, and this is a progression. I don't want to just live with Jesus being my answer man. Lord, give me this, give me that, take care of this, you know. Lord, I'm going to be flying from Washington to Texas, you know, put angels all over the wings to make sure I land or something, you know. And it's like, you know, well, I kind of need those angels over here where I've got a real need. No, put them on my plane. Not that you did that. But you see what I'm saying? No, put them on my plane so that I don't die. It's always that, isn't it? It's always self-survival on some front or another. Somehow we have made a distinction between the bride and the wife of the Lamb. Now, let us compare the other scriptures. All right, so we're still in Revelation, so turn with me to Revelation chapter 3, and I want to show you the promise to the church. This is a promise that, remember, this is coming out of the letters, right? So this is coming to the churches. Revelation 3, verse 12. Him that overcometh will I make a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go out no more out, and I will write upon him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, which is New Jerusalem, get ready, which cometh down out of heaven from God. It's almost as if it's trying to say it a lot, that this is what we're supposed to become. That we're supposed to be with him, see, with him. And, you know, in this role, you get a chance to be richer, poorer, or, you know, in sickness and health. You get a chance to go through all kind of things and still be with the Lord. Right? I mean, you do. You know, I mean, a lot of Christians don't believe this, but there's some rough things that we have to go through, but we get to go through them with him. And if we're blessed, we get to go through that with him and learn him through it. Oh, man, see, there's the payoff right there, because we're being changed from glory to glory into the same image then. And then when we've reached the bride stage instead of the Christian stage or the church stage, then we're not reaching for things, trying to figure out how should I act with him or da 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 da. You know, when you're in love, a lot of times you know how to act. It's when you're trying to do stuff. You know, it's like, oh, I need to do this, or I need to look a certain way, or, you know, da 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 da, all this kind of stuff, and you're more wrapped up in yourself. You know, I need to do this, I say this, I need to look a certain way, and da 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 da, and then, you know, come up to him and fumble around. He's going, I'm not going to say it. Anyway, did you have a comment?
When you were talking about going through these rough things, but we're going through with the Lord and learning Him in it, the verse that kind of went through my heart is that verse in Revelation that says, the cities of this world have become the cities.
The kingdoms.
Yeah, the kingdoms of this world has become the kingdoms. It's like, that's what that is.
That's what that is.
It's not just the cities getting saved.
No.
It's the cities getting saved.
That's right.
You know?
That's
and they're becoming one at a time, they're falling, and they're bending their knee to Jesus and He's possessing them because we're going with Him as the wife of the Lamb.
That's it. And that, by the way, is used several different places at the juncture where somebody, like the two witnesses or somebody, dies, and then all of a sudden it goes, oh, this is it. This is, you know, or the devil's being cast down. They're going, this is the glory and the power of God. And you're going, this is a nightmare. Yeah. Yes, did you have your hand up?
Well, I just noticed once that in chapter 3, the verse you just read about the city coming down, the letter to Philadelphia, that Philadelphia is a city, and even means brotherly love.
Yes.
But when the seals are opened, you're going to need the Lamb that comes down from above.
Right.
Not just a lot of love and a lot of personal goodness, because our best can endure what's going to make us bride. So you've got to have the Lamb written in us, or we won't endure. Even Philadelphia won't endure what's going to come to make us bride.
Mm-hmm. That's good. These scriptures in Revelation 3:12 are with the Church of Philadelphia, which we all go, they were the good ones.
Yes.
You know, they were the good ones. Everybody else was really messed up, but they're the good ones. Because they're the city of brotherly love. Oh, you know, anybody ever been to Philadelphia? I'm sure. You know. Just so you know, it is not as loving as you think it is. There are really dangerous places there. But, you know, brotherly love isn't enough. What is that? Phileo love. It's not agape. It's not love that lays down His life. By this perceive ye the agape of God. Because He laid down His life for us, and we ought to agape one another. We ought to lay down our lives for one another. And as was said by Kelly, that's Philadelphia is a city. And as Mallory said, he's trying to win the cities with his nature and by the Lamb being enthroned in us as a city so that he can dwell there. And it gets into that. I mean, this whole chapter gets into that. All right. So, and then the last part of verse 12 is, which cometh down out of heaven from God, and I will write upon him my new name. Oh my God, she's not going to just be a Christian, it's Christ. Yes. That's an improvement. You know? You can just be a city member, you know, a Philadelphian lives in the city of Philadelphia, Christian. You know, but when Christ is formed in you, that's not just living in that area or something. That's Him. Let's see, what did I have here? Okay, turn with me to Ephesians chapter 4. I want to read a couple of scriptures here. All right, now we have a tendency, when we read in a chapter, we have a tendency that once we've read what we've read, we sort of forget that and we move on. And then if we hit anything like it later on, we don't seem to be able to equate it back to what was said at first. So I want to read Ephesians 4, verse 1 through 3. I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that you walk worthy of the vocation wherewith you are called, with all lowliness and meekness, with long suffering, forbearing one another in love. What does forbearing mean? Putting up with. Forbearing one another is that you put up with that, but you do it in agape, which means what? well, I love them, so I'll put up with their stupid stuff. No, I lay down my life. I am with Jesus Christ and Him crucified in a certain spirit in this thing. I redeem all things. I mean, you know, you remember the scripture says you redeem an ass with a lamb. Well, in this situation, but I redeem that by the nature of the lamb. Amen? Try it, Mike. It'll work. Patty's going, yeah, Mike, try it. Okay, so, but there's more. With lowliness and meekness and long-suffering, forbearing one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. We're not trying to keep the bond of peace. I've had so many people teach from this, and they go, well, we need to keep the bond of peace. They're going, we need to keep the unity of the Spirit. You know? But again, we leave God out of it, and we make it a law. And beasts many times. All right, now I'm going to drop down to verse 8, and think of this in light of what we just read. Verse 8 through 10. Wherefore he saith, when he ascended up on high, he led captivity captive and gave gifts unto men. Parenthesis. Now that he ascended, but it is it, but that he also descended first into the lower parts of the earth. He that descended is the same also that ascended up far above all heavens, that he might fill all things. All right, anybody see a pattern there of what we've been talking about in the bride and that thing about ascending and descending? Here's what we usually get out of that. We get, oh, when he ascended on high, he led us captive and he gave gifts to men. Well, he did do that, but there it's trying to communicate a lot more than that. It's not just saying, whoopee, you get everything because he died. And that's the way you should live your Christian life. Whoopee! I get everything because, you know, Jesus died. I'm so glad he's dead. Or I wouldn't have anything. We would say, I'm so glad he died. Thank God for the resurrection. It gives us, it makes us look better. Because if he just died and didn't rise, we'd go, well, we'd have to say, thank God he's just dead, but look what I got out of it. You know, that spirit. Gave gifts unto men. Verse 9, now that he ascended, what is it but that he also descended first? Okay, there it is. Everything, and we'll see that here in just a minute, came because he descended. And that's why he was ascended. Okay? So it goes on to say, into the lower parts of the earth. He that descended is the same also that ascended. All right. So what is that saying? All right. So that is saying that if Jesus, we'll just put him as a circle on the cross. If Jesus died on the cross and he died, let's just put a lamb. Let's put an L on there so we know that's the Lamb of God dying. He that descended is same that ascended. He hasn't changed in his nature. He's still self-giving. We're the ones who think, well, I'll stay down for a while as long as I get resurrected and get into the glory part. Can I get an oh me? Yes, because that's the way we are. That's the way we are. We want to, you know, I just want to get into the good part. This spirit, we're supposed to be married to this. That's what we marry, you know. See, he didn't have to look like a lamb on the throne in the book of Revelation. He could have looked like this king with a, you know, this crown and all this stuff and these gold robes, you know, and all this stuff, and he's sitting on the throne going, they thought they had me, but I beat them in the end. We go, I want to follow that. That's beasts or beats. beasts. Beasts. That's beastly in its nature. We marry this. And see, that's the difference between Christianity and the wife of the Lamb, is that we're supposed to know what we're joined to and want to conform to it. We're supposed to know that. Whereas you can be a Christian, and you can be that for a good long while and not know this, and still have that beastly attitude and not know it's beastly. But God is faithful, and He will eventually deal with you. I don't know that everyone will come into that fullness right off, but that's His heart. That's His heart. Because why? See, we go, God does not desire that any perish, but all come to the knowledge of the truth. Well, that's true, and that's scriptural. Good, praise God. He didn't want anybody to die. He wants everybody to come to the knowledge of the truth. I think He's got a bigger agenda in His heart. He wants a wife, a bride after His kind. That's a bigger agenda. But maybe He didn't say that to Peter. Maybe He didn't say, well, let's talk about me. So He just put it in these terms that we would understand. God doesn't want any of us to perish. But it's not just to perish. He doesn't want anyone to be separated from Him. He that descended is the same also that ascended up far above all heavens, that He might fill all things. And so His goal is not just to come down and come up. Ascended, descended, da, da, da. He wants to fill all things. He wants to be the fullness of everything in His city, in His bride, in His wife. He wants to. And we get that picture here in chapter 21 and 22. That's the kind of thing it paints. There's no more this but the Lamb. There's no more that but the Lamb. There's no more all the things that we're used to, all the things that we depend on. No more. In her, it's the Lamb. Amen? All right. So, I don't even know if I'm reading here. Let me read. The wife descends, gets low in the earth, just as her husband did. It is this spirit that is the glory that he sees in her, having the glory of God. See, it says she's descending, having the glory of God. We're going, well, she must be really bright. She's real bright there. She's really, you know. The glory is Christ in you, the hope of glory. This is what he's looking at and going, she's one with me. I love her. Come here, baby. I don't think he talks like that. But anyway. Maybe he does. I don't know. I'm thinking all kind of things, but I'm not going to say them. And some of you are actually wishing that I would. This descent, her descending, having the glory of God, coming out from God, this descent is the fulfillment of Paul's words concerning our coming to the unity of the faith. Till we all come to the unity of the faith, knowledge of the Son of God. It keeps on going. I don't remember if I touch on that here, but I touched on it when I was searching this out, and it goes straight on down, and it goes into that he that descended after. That's afterwards, and then it moves on. Boy, I hope I didn't leave off something. The knowledge is not some deep teaching till we all come. The knowledge is not some deep teaching. Compare Revelation 3:12. In that verse, to overcome means to and results in the name of the city of God, which is New Jerusalem, being written on you. He's putting his bride's name on you and saying, that's mine. Okay. This is God, by the way. You know? And he's saying, that's mine. Don't mess with my woman. He does say that over, what is it, 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Check it out. It'll scare you. Because he's serious. Well, he's serious. He's serious. You know? New Jerusalem being written on you, but your identity is not just as the city of God, but as one descending or coming down from that exalted position the way Jesus did. See, we go, he wrote on me, wife of the Lamb, or he wrote on me, the city of God. We go, oh, you know, we get all the titles and all that stuff, but the real identification that we're supposed to be identifying is that we're coming down with him. We're getting low with him. We're not grasping after being above everything and above everybody. Well, I'll prove I'm with God. Jesus came down and they said, while he's hanging on the cross, if you're the Son of God, come down from the cross. And he said, I'm staying right here because I am the Son of God. This is my life. This is who I am. I will always go this direction. See? Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation. Somebody didn't, you know, I say this every time I get to this, but, you know, we get in situations and God has to humble us, so he does stuff and we lose our reputation, and then we go, I'm like Jesus. No, he made himself no reputation. You just got in trouble and lost it. I mean, there's a difference. Yeah. And took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men, and being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of a cross. So why is that written there? That's written there so that theologically we could understand the process by which Jesus, who was God, became man and then went to the cross. No, that's written there because he says, I want this mind in you. Verse 5. That's why it's there. It has nothing to do with theology on God's part. He's going, study of God, you know, theology, the study. Yeah. He's not interested in us dissecting his theology, as it were, but to find out what he's saying. And what he's saying here is, you know, Paul's writing this, but he got it from the Lord. So what if it was like Jesus sitting right there and saying, Paul, here's what I want you to write. Let this mind... And then show them what I'm like, my mind, my attitude. Show them, write it out for me. Show them how I came down, how I got low, how I didn't fight after reputation, how I did all of this and went lower and lower. Show them so that they'll understand me and they'll understand what they're joining to. Or Paul's just going, well, I'm a scholar. I will explain this to them, and they will know. Not so. Do we really comprehend James 1:17, or have we always read it from a carnal viewpoint? James 1:17, every good and perfect gift is from above and cometh down. Oop, there it is. See, well, here's what we get out of it. Every good and perfect gift comes from God. And, you know, yeah. And send some more. Send more. You know, I need more. Anyway, sorry. So it's every good and perfect gift is from above and cometh down from the Father of lights, with whom is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. Things that are from above or exalted are precious to him because it comes down. That's why it's precious, because it comes down from that exalted place, and he will not change his mind or have variableness about this area. Every good and perfect gift comes from above, comes down. If it's good and perfect, it's going to come down and give itself. James 1:17. We must realize that every good and perfect gift is not found up in heaven. What? That's where I'm going. I'm going. Yeah, that's why she's coming back down. She went, up. It's not here. I'm going back down. Okay, I'm going back. We must realize that every good and perfect gift is not found up in heaven, but is coming down from heaven. That's what makes it good and perfect. He wants this mind to be in us, which is found in Philippians 2, where it mentions that Jesus came down from above and became less and suffered. The perfecting of these things in us is not when we fully comprehend the concept or can chart it out on a blackboard. As James says of Abraham, this is still the book of James, as James says of Abraham, that it was not perfect, talking about the promise and his faith, it was not perfect until he offered Isaac. Anybody remember that? Was not Abraham our father justified by works when he offered Isaac his son upon the altar? Seest thou how faith wrought with his works, and by works was faith made perfect. The perfection of it is in the coming down, in the selfless giving of it, is the altar. You can say, I'm committed, I love Jesus, you know, well, forget you. Let's use Peter as an example. I will never deny you. I love you. I will die for you. I'm committed. I feel it. I really know it. You know? And Jesus said, hold it. Hold up there, Skippy. This day, you're going to deny me three times. Count them, Peter. Count them, Peter. This day, all of that commitment that you've been working up for weeks at the altar is just a human piece of wood. It's not an altar. I'm going to bring you to the altar. And he does. And there, when, you know, because you've heard me talk about the altered son, and I probably write it here, but Isaac at that time on Mount Moriah was the altered son, not altar like he was altered on the inside, but the altar. He became an altered son. Before that, he was my beloved son. He was the one I love. He was da-da-da-da. He was the one God gave me. Everything about him. I love this kid. This is God-given. And then God says, now let's perfect this. Take him to an altar. And James says, whatever happened before that really wasn't it. It all took place at the altar. And from that point on, this boy to Abraham was an altered son. It wasn't the same one that was before. He was not the only begotten anymore. He was the firstborn, because now from this would spring many, but that altar had to happen before that faith, that promise of faith that out of thee would come many. This is where it came from. And had this not happened, that as many as the stars would not have happened. See, the altar perfects everything. Perfects. Well, what is the altar? You're in your exalted position, just like Isaac was beforehand. And now he's coming down. Now it's all coming down. Good and perfect, God calls it. Perfect faith. Now your faith has been perfected. See that word? It's used over and over. And it's used in these same contexts. Hallelujah. Okay, let's see. Because we're almost. All right, I'll read this through and then we'll stop here. This is out of James 2, verse 21 through 23, if you want to jot this down. James 2, 21 through 23. Was not Abraham, our father, justified by works when he had offered Isaac his son upon the altar? Seest thou how faith wrought with his works? Okay, so what are the works here? The works are works of faith. He's acting upon this now. See, it's not, this is going to do it, because, you know, Paul's already said we're justified by faith, not by works. But this is the manifestation of faith that will actually take it to an altar, make an altar out of it, instead of just a blessing and a gift from God out of it. And see, that's us, man. God gives us something, and we want it for us, and we want to just suck it up, and we want to just, you know, all this kind of stuff. And we should learn that everything that God would bring to us, He brings it always and forever to bring into Him, and that would be brought by way of the cross. And if it is, it's moved into the realm of the eternal instead of the temporal. It has. You've literally, by your faith in believing that life comes out of death, you've taken that which is He has given, the promise, the blessing, the sweet thing that He might have given to you, and you've brought it to that altar before Him. And it just became eternal then. You're not going to lose it. Seest thou how faith wrought with his works, and by works faith was made perfect. See, there it is. His faith was made perfect. Now, it wasn't just words. Genesis 15, but Genesis 22 now. And the scripture was fulfilled. The scripture's finally fulfilled. See, we thought the fulfillment was when Isaac was born. The fulfillment is when Isaac is made an altered son. When we put Christ crucified in it, life will come out of it. Thank God, and it'll live. But you seek to save, and you lose. You lose for his sake. You take it to an altar for his sake. Woohoo! There's hope always in that. And the scripture was fulfilled, which saith, Abraham believed God, and it was imputed unto him for righteousness, and he was called the friend of God. After this, see, we always talk about Abraham being the friend of God, but it wasn't until he took him to the altar. That's where he really became a friend of God. Because now you think like I do. Now we're together. Now we're friends. This is the way I, you know, this is my kind of friendship. Greater love hath no man than this, that he lay down his life for his friend. See, true friendship has an altar in it. Amen? Okay, let's stop and we'll take a break. And I think she takes care of the snack.